So, growing up in Pakistan, a lot of what religion meant in my lived reality was that it's unquestionable. It is already decided, these are the rules, this is the revelation, and this is what the revelation means, and this is how it will be implemented in specific situations. Speaking of Fazlur Rahman, when I initially read some of the work by Fazlur Rahman, but also other scholars who would be considered relatively recent reformist, modernist scholars of Islam, I learned certain hermeneutics, certain ways of understanding Islam, understanding the revelation, which were very mind-opening for me. For instance, Fazlur Rahman, for instance, when he talks about the double movement of revelation, looking at the specifics of what you're reading, what it actually means, but then zooming out to the principle of what these specific rules are, and then zooming back into our time and applying those principles. So that kind of double movement kind of hermeneutics is sort of what we label now in different ways. For instance, progressive, some people call it the progressive movement, some people call it the modernist, some people call it liberal. And my task, what I wanted to do, was to see how it's implemented in daily lived reality. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that. There is a lot of literature out there, but what is happening when that literature or those strategies are implemented in ritual, implemented in daily lives? Some of the things that I've been looking at is interfaith marriages, the discourse on that, and actually live reality of that. Counterterrorism, the whole network of that, but also practice of that. Sharia councils. But specifically for this talk, I'm going to be talking about mixed gender prayers and female imams and inclusive mosques, and focusing on some of my experiences with the inclusive mosque initiative, but also kind of zooming back into the contemporary trend of, or the ways where you see a movement towards female inclusion in different aspects of ritual in Islam. To begin with, I'd like to talk about the importance of this. This is not just a debate in academia or in small segments within Muslim communities. This has become a broader debate about female participation in rituals. And from Pakistan, for instance, recently, Asma Jahangir, I'm sure a lot of you have heard of that name, has passed away. She was a human rights activist, very well known. And in her funeral prayers, her janazah prayers, something happened which a lot of people thought disturbing, while a lot of people thought very revolutionary and a positive trend. What happened was that in the janazah prayers, women were participating as well. They were present during that public aspect of the ritual of janazah, but also some of them were standing in the front row, which in the debates of Islamic legal tradition has been discussed. Can you do that? Where do women stand in the prayer congregation? And so this was a debate, but then it turned and became a legal issue in Pakistan, where there was an FIR registered against the participants of the congregation, and that FIR is now in process, and it could actually impact her daughters, Asma Jahangir's daughter, who were participating as well. So they're already grieving, and this is also happening. So this is why I think it's an important topic to discuss as well, because it is going to come up again and again in our live reality as Muslims and otherwise as well. Right, so to begin with, let's look at when I wanted to locate the scholarly tradition to the live reality, my first task was to look at where is this community? How do I find this community? It's not like clear cut, like, you know, okay, I'm going to go to a Hanafi mosque or a Shia or an Ahmadi area. It's this community or this discursive community does not, it's not coalesced as a clear community at the present moment. So I wanted to have a label to try to locate people, and what I tried to do was, the label that I was working with was progressive Muslims, but when I started talking to people on ground, a lot of people actually reacted to that term. Some people, I'll quote, some people said, it is an Oriental term, it makes other Muslims look primitive. Other people said, why this opposition of, you know, oppositional category of good Muslims who don't threaten us versus bad Muslims who just don't integrate? This is what progressive stands for. These are not people who are against the ideas of progressive sun. These are people who are participating in these communities who are saying, we don't like this term that you're using for us. Islam has always been progressing and changing, so it doesn't make sense to say that we're progressive Muslims. And other comments like that. Then I asked about other labels that they would prefer. Some people would say simply Muslim. They would say, we're Muslims. We don't even want any specific type of Muslim. We're just Muslim. Other people would use other terms like fundamentalist, because we're going back to the principles, the fundamentals of Islam. Critical Muslims is a term that I've heard some people say, liberal. So the point is that there is no clear agreement about the self-identification. But what we can do is figure out, are there any shared norms and values of people and their practices? And some of the things that I've noticed, and I've noticed in the practice, in the discussions, but also in the literature, websites as well, is a need to engage with the tradition. So unlike a lot of like secular Muslims or secular liberal Muslims, a lot of Muslims that I'm talking to are religious, and they do want to engage with the traditions when they're talking about making any claim. So using the hadith in some instances, but more specifically the Quran. And some people would also use the legal traditions in certain cases. So with this community, there are certain norms that we can identify. One is the focus on justice as a concept, especially social justice. And this comes not only from the debates that are happening in society already. These are very current debates, for instance, feminist discourses, gender justice, pluralism. But also, they excavate the tradition of Islam and find those discourses happening before as well. This is not just a West versus Islam debate. They're bringing in discourses and traditions within Islam to answer these questions. Now, the broader socio-cultural context of this is, one, these debates which are already happening, for instance, the Me Too movement, but questions about interfaith marriages, questions about sexuality, all of these things are happening around. So people are struggling with it already. But what else is changing, which is leading to a progressive or reformist sort of practice in Islam, is that there is what Vertovic, one of the scholars, says, there's a super diversity in certain contexts in the world. For instance, in London or UK, you see a lot of different communities coming together, Muslim communities from different places. So the terms that people used before, let's say Pakistani or Bangladeshi or I'm Tunisian, aren't the most salient ones. But Muslim, for instance, can be very salient. It ties to a lot of people together. It forms different kinds of communities, which make more sense to people these days. And the second thing that's happening, especially after post 9/11, all of you must have noticed this, is that the term Muslim, or the identification, the religious identification, is being elicited more from the social context as well. Let's talk about media, for instance. There would be shows like Muslims Like Us or other shows which specifically bring together people, and what draws them together is this identity of being Muslim. How do people, even technology, you know, how people meet. There's like all of these like apps where people can meet each other, Muzmatch and all of that. So what's tying people, what's the salient identity that's highlighted? It's the religious identity. So for a number of reasons, people are more conscious of their religious identity. This is part of the context which brings this need to engage with the tradition and engage with how it's practiced. Now, coming to specifically the idea of ritual leadership of women and the role of women in mosques, this reflects some of the larger trends in Christianity and Judaism as well, where there has been debates about leadership as well. Now, within Islam, it's a recent debate that's propped up, but it is not a debate which has never happened in Islamic or Muslim context. What I've looked at is, first of all, in the literature, but also in the discussion in the communities, is that the when we look at the Quran, it does not directly speak about the issue of female leadership in prayers, not forbidding it, not specifically addressing it. But it does talk a lot about spiritual and practical responsibilities and equality, ontological equality of all human beings, regardless of gender. So then what do we base these traditions on of mixed gender prayers and female imam? One of the hadiths which is used is the Waraka hadith, and it's been debated a lot. This was a woman during the time of the Prophet who the Prophet, according to this hadith, asked her to lead prayers in Al-Adhal, her Dariha, her sort of, this term is debated. What does Al-Dariha mean? Was it her house, her family, her neighborhood, her community? But regardless, what this hadith basically says is a woman was asked to lead a mixed congregation. There is some debate whether this was mixed congregation or not, but overwhelmingly, people agree that this was a mixed congregation. We don't know exactly what kind of congregation. Was it just the family or a broader congregation? But this hadith often comes up in justifying that there is a precedence in Islamic tradition for female ritual leadership in prayers. Now, when it comes to the fiqh, it seems at surface level very obvious what the stance is. The Maliki school forbids it completely. Hanafi school considers it makruh, disliked. So we're talking about now when I'm saying what the stance is about women leading women. So it's not about women leading men in prayers or mixed congregation. So these Maliki forbids women leading women and Hanafi makruh. But the other two say that it's allowed with certain differences. But with recent research, for instance, by Julian Hammer and Amna Wadood and other scholars, they've excavated a lot of discussions in the Islamic judicial tradition that it was not as clear-cut, and there were minority opinions as well. And when we talk about ijma means a consensus of certain scholars, but not all scholars were consulted, not the whole community, and there were always varying opinions within the tradition. And we have a bunch of different, for instance, Ibn Taymiyyah, who's well known as one of the predecessors of the Hanafi sort of tradition, he supported it, also Ibn Arabi. Okay, so coming to the more concrete, what I want to focus on is Inclusive Mosque Initiative, and what it stands for and what IMI has been doing. It was founded in 2012 by two queer Muslim women, Dervla and Tamsila. And they both have extensive experience with activism, women activism, as well as like activism with gender and sexuality. But what they notice is often in the UK context, fighting for gender and sexuality often becomes a very secular enterprise rather than a religious enterprise. So they wanted to create a space which also practiced religion while talking about all of these other issues as well. So they created the Inclusive Mosque Initiative. Right now, it has six female board members, so it's a female-led institution. It has one full-time staff member. There are 30-plus volunteers. Around 6,000 plus Facebook page, people who like it. They have different conferences and they can have up to around 200 people attending. The purpose, the aim of the Inclusive Mosque Initiative was to create an inclusive space, but also a sacred space that respects diversity, the natural environment, and creates values of gender expression and gender justice as traditions of Islam, as part of Islamic tradition. The Inclusive Mosque Initiative it's inclusive. That is the part that I should stress, that they do not necessarily consider themselves as a progressive institute, more as an organization that includes different people. So they have Quranists, they have Sufis, they have Shia, Sunnis, Bareilvis, different type of people, or non-believers as well. They have a branch active in Pakistan as well. And they have different socioeconomic classes and ethnicities. They don't. So the main thing that is happening in Inclusive Mosque circles right now is a fortnightly Jummah prayer. But they have other services that they offer as well. The fortnightly Jummah I'm going to talk about briefly. What happens is that there's no one imam. They can be male and female, and they alternate. And they follow different traditions they could be Shia ways of praying or Sunni ways, and they encourage diversity in practice. When you go to the Inclusive Mosque space, you would see certain similarities with any other mosque. You would see that there is, for instance, the tradition of khutbah and the azan followed by the azan, the namaz, the salat, and you have some things different. And what is different is that men and women are praying side by side, sometimes standing in the same line. So there is no concept of a segregation or an idea that men, based on gender, you should stand anywhere. Women can lead the prayer not only as khatibs, as sermon providers, but also as leaders, imams. So they lead the prayers standing in front of the congregation. They also can be muezzin, so they can actually sound the call of azan as well. So that makes it controversial as well as revolutionary in some ways, because these are things which are has been done. This is not the first time that any of this has been done, but it is relatively recent. In 1994 onwards, these trends we see more from South Africa to Europe to North America. But these are relatively recent trends. Another thing that the Inclusive Mosque Initiative focuses on is that they encourage inclusiveness of for people who have different abilities or disabilities as well. So the azan, when that happens, they always make sure that there is sign language as well, BSL, British Sign Language, somebody there to do that as well. And another service that they provide other than the azan is nikah services. Around 12 annually, they get people asking for them to be in their nikah services, in their nikah. And some of the things which make this nikah different is that there is no specific requirement of having a wali, for instance, having somebody give the woman off to the husband. And there is a lot more consultation with the couple, and there's more flexibility as well in how that service is provided to the people. There are also conferences. For instance, there's going to be a conference, I'm just going to plug it in really quickly, on the 3rd of March on Islamophobia. How do we build action against Islamophobia? And it will debate all of those issues that we were talking about, the term Islamophobia and what it means and what do we do with anti-Muslim bigotry as well. So that's the kinds of discussions that Inclusive Mosque Initiative is also bringing up. It's also encouraging people on social media to talk about issues of gender justice, not only in terms of ritual leadership, but also in terms of everyday practice in families as well. So we have another conference which was about gender justice, where Amna Wadood came, and she spoke about the importance of looking at our tradition, looking at our Quran, Hadith, but also our current crises almost of authority, who gets to speak and what do they speak about Islam, and how does that impact our lives. So the Inclusive Mosque Initiative is iconic in my view of a discourse which has been happening in academia, in theology, that looks at how do we know what the revelation means and how do we practice it. And it brings it in a concrete way in a very specific domain of ritual practice. How do we actually pray? And who leads the prayer and why is it important? Why should we care who leads the prayer? What does that mean in terms of power dynamics? So that's why I think it's important to look at these trends of how do we translate theology into practice. Thank you.